Okay.
He showing up. Father, I stretch my hand to thee, Lord, and up I go. If I withdraw myself from thee, Lord, where shall I go? Father God, I ask now that you come. Decrease me, God, in order that you increase, that this congregation will no longer see me, but the Christ that liveth within me. Bread of heaven, feed us till we want no more. Now that the words of my mouth, the meditation of thine heart, is acceptable in thy sight. For truly you are our strength and our redeemer, but most of all you are our friend. And we love you in the name of the Lord. Say, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Keep showing up. Today is a new day. We made it to the end of one week and the start of another week. But sometimes that doesn't bring an exciting feeling. Oftentimes we look back and think about our failures and our frustrations. We wonder why we weren't able to accomplish this, or wonder why did God allow that to happen. But the beautiful thing about life is the simple fact that God is always in control. God makes us face the challenge, and then God also gives us strength to overcome the challenge. Charles Swindoll, who coined the phrase, life is 10% of what happens to you and 90% of how you respond. He suggests to us that what happens to you in life pales in comparison to what you do with it and how you respond to it. In other words, you have options. Your response to a matter is either more monumental than your actual issue. What you do is more important than that which is done unto you. How you react to a situation, it is not how you react to a situation, but rather how you respond to your circumstance that makes the difference. A reaction is based out of temporary and immediate feelings, but a response is based out of method, thought, and intentions with a purposeful choice. Reactions are momentary and short-lasting based on feelings. In other words, I do what I feel like doing up to then and do what you think I ought not to do. But when I respond to a situation, I have taken time to understand that just because I feel a certain way doesn't mean I can act a certain way. I mean, you know, we got church folk that want to cut food every now and then when things don't go their way. It might not happen in old Pilgrim, but Sister so-and-so didn't do this, and Brother so-and-so didn't do that, so I don't want to be a part of that ministry. But how many know that everybody has a responsibility? There's no big eyes and little ears in the house of the Lord. We have to be a unified body in order for the church to grow. It's not about Pastor Norman or First Lady Norman. It's about being a unified body in Christ. A church divided cannot stand. Can I get a witness in here? Being in Christ has taught me to understand that no matter what the circumstance is, I must learn how to respond rather than react. The truth of the matter is I react and I do things based on how I feel at the moment or based on what things look like to me logically. When I respond to life circumstances I may not have logical explanation, I trust that my resolve is always the best response. Responsiveness pulls you out of the logic and puts you into the realm of faith. When you respond to a situation that may not make sense to you or anyone else around you because you don't walk according to what you see, but rather by what you do not see. In other words, you walk by faith and not by sight. Your response does not always make sense because response don't deal in logic, but rather in faith. So here now in our text, we find a very exemplary personification that the very principle that your response can determine your outcome. Understand in the 13th chapter, we met a woman who had been bent over for 18 years. She has a debilitating condition that has limited her ability to move properly. She has a condition that physically has placed her in a posture of dysfunctional mobility. All she sees is that which is beneath her. It is hard for her to look up and to lift her head when things are going bad. How many of us know that every time the devil get on our track, rather than looking to the hills from which cometh our help, we get in this pity party and say, God, I can't take it no more. But how many of us know that the race is not given to the swift nor the strong, but to those who do it to the end? How many battle warriors do I have on this field called life? Are you ready to throw in the towel every time something happens? But baby, that's life. There's going to be good days. There's going to be bad days. You're going to have some hills to climb. Every experience is not going to be a mountaintop experience. Sometimes you got to walk through the valley. I mean, you heard this cliche, sometimes you got to crawl before you walk. Every now and then we want to always be on top, but God don't always want us to be on top. Sometimes he needs the little people that's running behind the scenes to fulfill his mission and to fulfill his purpose. Everybody can't be big dogs. Just as big as much as he used the big people. Everybody has a part. The Bible tells us that the body is many parts. But one part can't work without the other. Your head can't work work without your neck. Your hands can't work without your arm. Your feet can't work without your legs. So is the body of Christ. The pastor Norman can't work without his deacons. The deacons can't work without the trustees. The trustees can't work without the ushers. The ushers can't work without the missionary. The missionary can't work without the YWA. The YWAs can't work without the youth. We're all one body in Christ. So we all got to work together. I believe some of us this morning can identify with a woman that life has pushed you to a place where it's hard to take to look up now. Life has beat you up to a point where looking up is harder than it seems. We all know how to bear pain, how to put on a good face, how to hold it all together. So a lot of us come here Sunday after Sunday, we put on a happy face, but deep down inside we're broken, we're busted, we're disgusted. So I just don't want to go today, but I'm going to go anyhow because this is what I'm going to talk. We come out of tradition. We don't come looking for expectation. We don't come looking to receive. We just come to fill up a pew. Amen. But some of you come in here drained and downtrodden and broken and bent over. You've been over from guilt and defeat. You've been over from violence and hurt. You've been over from the abuse. You've been over from unhealthy emotions. You've been over from grief and you've been over from heartaches and you've been over from heartbreaks and you've been over from rejection and disappointment and depression. And you've been over from this and you've been over from that. And you've been for years and years come with the same thing but not yearning for a change in your life. You got to be willing to want the change. You got to be willing to want to grow. In your life. If you stay where you are, you're going to always be where you are. But you got to want it in your heart to know, for God I live and for God I die. Hell or high water, God, I'm going to serve you in spite of when I feel good, when I don't feel good, when I look good, when I don't look good, when my hair's fixed, my hair's not fixed, when I got my best friend.
Discouraged by
of situation because some reason God thinks that we can handle what we're going through. Yeah. Well, we want to give up and say, God, I can't do it. If he didn't give it to you, he meant that you can bear. But God never puts more on you than you can bear. Yeah. Can I get a witness in here? I don't know who I'm talking to this morning, what you're doing and what you're going through, because God thinks you can handle it. That means you're stronger than you know. Sometimes we don't know how strong we are until we've been strong and been put through a test. How many of you know that tea can't make tea until it's put in hot water? But that is good news to me because God sees something in me that I don't even see in myself. How many of you ever feel like giving up on yourself? But sometimes you gotta be like David, pat yourself on the back and say, I don't care if you're my own self in the Lord. I don't care if you don't like it. I don't care if mama don't like it. I don't care if daddy don't like it. As long as I got God, I'm gonna encourage myself in the Lord. When I'm down, I say, God, I'm gonna pick myself up. I gotta keep moving. I gotta keep striving. I gotta keep going. Because I know, Father God, that there's something greater at the end. How many of you know that every storm has to come to an end? This means I'm big enough, strong enough, great enough, because God himself thinks that I can handle this. So for 18 years, she was bent over with the inability to stand up. But what I have come to suggest to you today is that her healing is not so much about her need for change, but her healing is based on how she responds to her condition. But the Bible says that on the Sabbath day, Jesus was teaching in the synagogue, and a woman was there. Where is there? She was in the synagogue. Jesus is, she means to tell me she has an infirmity. She has an issue. She has an overwhelming oppression, which makes it difficult for her to move or even exist. Yet for some reason, when she found out where Jesus was, she found herself there in worship. Can you worship when you're in pain? Can you worship when you have money in your pocket? Can you worship when you have food on your table? Can you worship when you don't have money in your pocket? Can you worship when you don't have food on your table? Can you worship when your gas tank is on a fourth of a tank and you don't know how you're going to get the work for the rest of the week? Can you trust God to make a way out of no way? Can you trust God to be a healer of the troubled water? Can you trust God to be a healer of the new man? I feel like can you worship when you in this body with more permission? So you mean to tell me she was bent over, but she was still in worship. She was tired, but she was still in worship. She was frustrated, but she was still in worship. She was fed up, but now she was still in worship. And for some of you today, you're about to be blessed just because you showed up. Just because you showed up, you're about to be blessed. I know you've been tried, you've been frustrated. It's been a long week, and you just say, God, I don't know. I don't feel like going. The devil tried to put it in. Stay in the bed today. Have an appointment with Pastor Pillars and Deacon Sheets over there at Bedside Baptist. But you passed away. Just because you showed up. Why do people tell you about to be a blessing? About to be a blessing.
And he gave an unorthodox blessing, a miracle, and an unorthodox setting on an unorthodox day. He wasn't supposed to do that on the Sabbath day, but just because she showed up, I blessed her. I'm not qualified, but it's about to bless me. I'm not next in line because I showed up. He's about to do something in my life just because I showed up. He's going to do something in your mind that's going to blow your neighbor's mind, it's going to blow your haters' mind. Don't let your haters knock you down, let your haters be more elevated. Because God is trying to take you somewhere. I know for 18 years you've been trying. I don't know what you all have been through with things. Maybe a little rough things, maybe a little weird. But you got to hold on to God's unchanging hand. God's love is never failing. I want you to know that you're in a season where God is about to blow your mind. Is there anybody here ready for God to blow your mind? Jesus rewarded his way just to do something unorthodox to blow your mind. The woman is there to worship without expectation. I know you can come and just say, God, I don't ask you for nothing, but I want to thank you for everything. Come on, somebody. It ain't always about asking God for something. You got to thank him for things.
Yeah.
Just keep showing up. Yeah.